You all are pretty familiar with the men to your right and left. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Mahatma Gandhi, two very significant social figures who dedicated their lives to causes that would change the course of history and leave behind a lasting legacy, touching the lives of many during and long after their own time. So, why don't you know this woman in the middle of such greatness?
May 1st, 1933, also known as May Day. Masses gathered around European capitals like Berlin to hear Adolf Hitler speak.
Unser Fahnenträger und Führer hat das Wort.
And in the Soviet Union, Joseph Stalin.
Германия поставила на колени Красной армии и войсками наших союзников. Признала себя побежденной и объявила.
Meanwhile, on this day, I was handing out copies of the first edition of The Catholic Worker with a few friends. Me and Peter Morin, I'll introduce you to him later, had been working on this new periodical for a long time. Wait. I'm getting a little ahead of myself. It was a long time coming before this historic day. I was born on November 8th, 1896, in good old Bath Beach, Brooklyn, New York. My pops wrote about sports for the newspapers, so I grew up around writing. Actually, my brothers and I came up with our own family newspaper for fun back in the day. Growing up, we did quite a bit of moving around, but we always found ourselves in some major American city, whether it be Brooklyn, Berkeley, or Chicago. All that moving never shook up my parents' quiet, conservative, Protestant morals, though. They were only Protestant by label, because we never talked much about God or religion. As a naturally curious 8-year-old, I attended a Methodist Sunday school and was intrigued by rituals and religious practices. I always loved reading. In high school, I got into writers like Tolstoy and Dostoevsky. Ooh, one of my favorites was Upton Sinclair's The Jungle, which shed light on the disturbing conditions of immigrant workers in the meatpacking industry of Chicago, where I was actually living at the time. As soon as I read it, I started sneaking off to see those places discussed in the book firsthand. When I was 16, I received the Hearst Scholarship to attend the University of Illinois at Urbana. I didn't particularly love school all that much, but during my time there, I joined a socialist club on campus. Eventually, though, I dropped out of college to move with my family to New York when my dad received a new job at a newspaper in the city. I really wanted to work for that same newspaper and thought I'd have a chance since my dad was already there, but he had other plans for me. He had the folks there give me a little talk about the so-called place of a woman, and in their narrow definition, that place definitely wasn't at their newspaper. After that day, I packed up my things from home and finally left the nest. I was on my own for good and trying to find my place in the world. Around this time in my life, I had a few romantic interests come in and out of the picture. But I was in my 20s, guys. Come on. You probably know what that's like. It was during this time that I became pregnant. It is difficult to talk about and comes as a surprise to many. But the man I was with didn't want me to keep the baby, and being young and naive, I listened to him and got an abortion, thinking it would fix things. But we ended up going our separate ways shortly after. It was a pretty dark time, to say the least. After dropping out of college, I started working for radical newspapers such as The Call of the Masses and The Liberator. It was during this time that I was sent on assignments to cover protests, picketing, and speeches. I was instantly hooked. I knew I had become a part of this new American voice. I did it all, from protesting the World War I draft, to women's suffrage. I even did quite some time in the slammer for rattling conservative cages. To skip ahead a little, in 1924, I thought I had found the one. I met a dreamy, like-minded activist and biologist, Forster Batterham. We were together for quite some time, and we even bought a lovely little house together on a beach in Staten Island. Forster and I brought our beautiful baby girl, Tamar Teresa, into the world. Although, that wasn't enough to keep us together. Tamar became quite sick with a chronic digestive disorder, and we were always in and out of the hospital. The hospital bills kept racking up, and we were unsure if our little angel was going to make it. It was during this very dark time that I found God. I guess I always knew He was there. I just struggled with reconciling my radical ideals with religion. But after this point, I made it my life mission to bring these worlds of religion and activism together. And admit- Now, back to where I started. In the winter of 1932, I met Peter Morin. Well, it definitely wasn't by chance.
Sheesh, Dorothy. Don't give them the wrong idea about me.
Well, you kind of stalked me for a bit, did you not?
I was just impressed by your work and thought we could help each other out. After I saw all the work you did advocating for social justice issues, I knew that you would appreciate and understand my philosophies concerning personalism and distributism, as well as my Catholic upbringing.
And thank God you did. We had been working on it for a while, and as soon as we had enough money, we got the Catholic Worker printed in copies, ready for distribution in New York City's Union Square on the now historic May 1st, 1933. The Catholic Worker was considered as the Catholic answer against communism, and the journal for the poor laboring man fighting for social justice. It brought exposure to social justice issues that were often pushed aside or overlooked. The Catholic Worker was not just a periodical, but a movement. All the while, I was writing for the Catholic Worker and getting it out to the people. We founded farming communes to remedy the lack of employment opportunities of the time, as well as houses of hospitality, which to this day stand to shelter and feed the poor. I left this world in the year 1980 when I was 83 years old. Up until my very last days, I gave my everything to the Catholic Worker movement, and I'm extremely proud and happy to see it still going strong. It always struck us as odd that our writing and work was labeled as radical. To quote Peter Morin's essay in The Catholic Worker, "The Catholic Worker believes in the gentle personalism of traditional Catholicism. The Catholic Worker believes in the personal obligation of looking after the needs of our brother. The Catholic Worker believes in creating a new society within the shell of the old with the philosophy of the new, which is not a new philosophy, but a very old philosophy, a philosophy so old that it looks new." The Catholic Worker movement was not far off from the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. Was it not He who acted as the voice of the poor, the sick, the disadvantaged, and helped them from His own resources and power? That's all we're trying to do. It's rather strange that they're trying to canonize me a saint. I'm just a simple woman simply trying to help my neighbor.
Dorothy Day has inspired countless others through her activism, writing, and faith. She dedicated her life to helping all people, especially those less fortunate. A large part of the Catholic Worker philosophy was personalism, and not in the sense of just being an individual, but finding the power and resources within oneself to create change. This vision of personalism cautioned against being a referral agency or relying on other people's or institutions for change. Dorothy Day brought Catholicism back to its roots by emphasizing the idea that as capable individuals, we should seek to help and serve those in need of it, and in doing so, recognize our significance within the larger picture of life. So the next time you are looking for inspiration, think of Dorothy, and you'll probably ask yourself, as we did, why you didn't hear of her sooner.